In my previous life, 19th century, Victorian times, I was a German, prominent German. And then I dropped the body and went to afterlife, to a much, much more beautiful place in this world. I forgot all about the world. In the afterlife, we don't keep paying attention to this world. No, good riddance, you know. We're going to a way better place in this world. So when I came, I had this spiritual intuition that there was going to be trouble in the world. We're more aware in the afterlife in various ways. And there's a general understanding that there's trouble coming. And so I volunteered to come back here and help out. So coming back here, when I remember I was like second or third grade, and it began dawning on me. I began to read and listen and ask questions. And I found out about World War II, World War I, and what, you know, the Nazis, what happened and what took place. And I was absolutely devastated and ashamed and just distraught. You know, as someone had great pride in Germany and being a German, German culture was a great culture at that time. I was just beside myself with shame for what had happened, and I decided I'm going to find out why it happened and try to prevent it from ever happening again. So I became a very, very keen observer of society, and I've remained that way my entire life. So I really have a great deal of investment in making very clear discernments about trends in society and trends that I feel are very dangerous trends. I have a lot invested in this. I don't want it to happen again. It's a terrible thing to go through, and especially if you're identified with a country and have so much pride in trying to help out culture, and then something like that happens, it's just awful. So I really do want to stop, prevent, and sound the alarm. If I see something, I sound the alarm. That's what I've been doing in these videos. I'm sounding the alarm. I'm seeing very bad trends here in this world. And I've made myself into an expert about these global trends in terms of how things happen in this world. How did World War II happen? How did the Nazi thing happen? It was absolutely terrible. Where did all these people come from? The brown shirts, the Gestapo, the SS, you know, the German war machine. Well, how did, well, you know, it did happen, didn't it? And you have to see, you know, what sociological trends, educational trends, karmic trends, all sorts of different trends blending together. But they were waiting in the weeds, and when the call came for them, boom, they were there. So you have to look at society and to see, you know, what's really going on. Okay, so with that in mind, I'm not just talking off the top of my head. I really, really have applied myself to this throughout my life, continuously. This is one of my, you know, pet projects that means a lot to me. Just from the mortification of, I actually tried to turn German culture in the right direction in the 19th century, because I felt it was going in a very dangerous Wagnerian trend towards this ultra heroic sort of, you know, super race mindset sort of thing, this mythological sort of using the Norse gods and the pagan gods. You know, they're using the pagan gods to stir up this feeling of aggrandizement, humanistic and grand aggrandizement. So I was aware that this is a very, very dangerous trend, and tried to, I was like maybe the leading voice of trying to stop this in Germany. So when I see this stuff going on here in the Western world, in the world in general, I say, I sound the alarm. I say, folks, we are really in big trouble here, to say the least. The ultimate trouble here is materialism, is arrogance, trying to get rid of any truth in this world, any following and usage of the grace of God, of spiritual um, literacy, great spiritual literacy and familiarity and belief and use of, like, prayer, for instance. They're trying desperately to get rid of prayer. Prayer is the most important aspect of our education, actually. Learning right prayer is key to our ultimate salvation and liberation from suffering and from death. And there's been a massive war against prayer in this world. So there's huge push to get rid of religion, get rid of spiritual momentum, spiritual belief, faith, momentum, and practice in this world, and to polarize it into some sort of mush, you know, that doesn't have any really juice to it at all. And to ultimately rewrite history, which would just completely write out all the saints, all the great success that we've had in the past. The Google, for instance, never has a saint up on their, you know, when the Google Doodles page, they always highlight some secular humanist. Always. It's as if all these tech companies act as if religion doesn't exist and has never existed. As far as they're concerned, they'd be happy if it never existed. Like the categories they give you, like the YouTube, the videos, you can choose like what category, you know, education, entertainment, politics, sports, you know, blah, blah. There's no religions, no spiritual religious category at all. This is throughout the internet, throughout technology, that's this way. They would dance with joy if history was rewritten and there was not a single mention of any saint, savior, guru, bodhisattva, arhat, enlightened master, not non-dual sage, you know, savior, avatar, etc., 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 rabbi, you name it, imam, spiritual leader, you know, great savior, you know, great liberator, Buddha mind, Rinpoche's, lamas, you go on and on. They would love for all of that to be just written out of history, that it never happened. This is their nirvana. Okay, so this is a humanistic nirvana. This is what they're going for. And they're about ready to make their play. Starting May 27th, a couple days away, I suspect it's going to begin to roll out. Okay. In one way or the other. And they're chomping at the bit. They already ignore it all. So imagine a society that ignores it to an extent that anyone who talks about it is seen as insane or needed some sort of therapy. Like, that really was just, those are just stories. You can't believe any of those stories. Those are silly stories of the past. Well, imagine the arrogance of that in this world, the sheer arrogance of denying the incredible body of evidence for the grace of God. The unbelievable body of evidence for the grace of God. And that there's a huge amount of people in this world, especially young people, who are willing to do just that, to ignore it and say it never happened. This is nothing but sheer arrogance on their part. Of course, arrogance believes that the cure for arrogance is more arrogance. Of course, make arrogance stronger so it can just arrogate and say, you know what, arrogance is great. Now, we're all happy. And arrogance makes us happy. Therefore, we're all great and we're all happy. That's the end of the story. That's what arrogance wants to do. So, a couple of antidotes here that I will lay on you here. Just be aware of this. I've been warning you, of course, about what I call the quote-unquote the yoga girls thing. The most dangerous aspect of humanism, actually. And just, there's many aspects to it. There are many angles and aspects happening, but I'd say that's the most dangerous one. They're the ones most capable of pulling us down, especially the ones that are most resistant. They can even pull the saints down if the saints don't take refuge. So, very dangerous. This is why Vajrayogini has stepped in. And I'll explain why. It takes a woman to deal with a woman, actually. Especially the yoga girls. It takes the queen of the dakinis to deal with these yoga girls and protect us from them. the priest was giving this his homily last Sunday, Catholic priest, and he said he visits prisons, jails, prisons. And he said he went to this prison he talks to the inmates and visits them, and he helps talk to them about their families and let them know that the church and people are caring about them. We haven't forgot about them. And he says it's very, very, very well received. And he says, I'd like to visit everyone, but he says, I actually only visit the men. And he says, let me explain. He says that the prison guards and the wardens of the prison, that run the prison, they won't let me visit the women's prison. And he said, I asked them why. He said, they're too vicious. They're much more vicious than the men. And he says, well, what do you mean by that? Says, what do you mean by that? He said, they'll kill you. So we cannot let you go in there, but you can go and visit the men. He's like, wow. He says, well, I don't want to die, so I think I'll go visit the men. And he says, he goes and visits the men look all intimidating with all the tattoos and all pumped up, like really intimidating, dangerous people. But then when you start talking to them about their kids and their family, he says they just turn into like puppy dogs, it's all show. But the women know. It's serious business. They're vicious. Women criminals, vicious. So then there's this anecdote of this 11-year-old boy. He told me he's now like 40-something. I don't know how old he is now, but he's middle-aged. But he was 11 years old when Mount St. Helens erupted up in Olympia, Washington, and he saw civilization collapse and everyone be turned into barbarians all for themselves. And he told me, he said, the ones that were most vicious by far were the women. He was shocked by it. He never forgot it, how shocking that was. Now today, I'm walking through this parking lot in the grocery store. I see this car, I see this woman in a car, and I'm walking in front of her, and just, of course, I'm pedestrian walking towards the grocery store. The car waits till they go by, but she didn't wait. She would just start driving right towards me, like she was going to run me down. And I saw it, and I had a premonition about the whole thing. And so I was watching her carefully. I saw it. I said, you know what? I don't think she's going to stop. So I quickly leapt out of the way. And then she kind of saw me, and like I hit the brake, and she looked at me. And she goes, oh my, she goes, oh my God, I did see you. The sun was in my eyes. I said, wave my hand. I said, okay, yeah, right. If I'd been looking at a smartphone or something, I'd been paying attention, I would have gotten run over and killed. But don't look at your smartphone in a parking lot, okay? Don't look at your phone. Keep your head up. Now, I got in my vehicle and I turned towards the sun and started driving to see how bad it was. It was bad. The sun was low in the sky. See, I understand it was hitting her windshield. But I could still see. I could still see. You could see a pedestrian. Certainly peripherally, you could see a pedestrian. So I had a premonition of this whole thing. I said, I think that lady's going to try to run me over. And son of a gun, she did try. Fortunately, I've been working out, and I'm very quick on my feet right now, like a cat. And the Holy Spirit has told me, you need to be like a cat right now. And I can scoot. I can jump. I can leap. I can scoot. Remember that rattlesnake? I leapt across the path. Make sure it couldn't strike me. The Holy Spirit has told me, you got to be able to leap. Now, this is just a physical thing, but I think mentally is also talking about, you have to be able to make a mental leap. You have to be capable of these mental leaps, because leading the charge of materialism is the feminine component, and they're way more vicious than the men. I can deal with the men. It's like that priest, he could deal with these very scary-looking male inmates, and it's not a problem for him at all. But I can't deal with the women. I mean by that, the vicious, arrogant, spiritual, materialistic women. Of course, not all women. Of course, a lot of women. The another anecdote. I'm working out, and there's this yoga girl, and she's walking, and she has this massive Doberman pincher. with this huge studded collar, you know, that, I mean, it's just like very, very intimidating. And she's just walking along like without a care in the world. Well, yeah, I mean, but other people are like, wow, keep that dog away from me, you know. I mean, that's a scary, scary dog. But she says, I got this dog, and if anything I don't like, I can you know, tell the dog go get him. Don't think that they won't either. So that's another antidote. But I took it in the right way. I always try to take it in the right way. There was a warning. It says, don't waste your time. She was going around in this loop. I said, don't waste your time in this loop. Go up and down the hill. You know, don't waste your time in the loop here. Don't go around and around in the world horizontally. Go vertically. Okay, so it's all good. I mean, everybody is helping me out. So that woman looking into the sun, what's the sun? It's the false light. I mean, it's technically of the true light, but it's our attempt for the true light to change what it is. So the solar light is light pretending to be not light, not what it is. True, the living light pretending to be dead light, actually. So she's looking at the dead light. She's blinded by the dead light, which is really blinded by arrogance. So this was, she was just pointing out to me, and I thank her for it, that the yoga girls are blinded by arrogance. They're like the new SS, actually. Everybody's looking, well, there's plenty of ruffians and thugs in among the males who have been carefully cultivated by these yoga girl types, actually. A lot of females have cultivated them, these thugs. But the women, these Amazon women, they are really vicious. Some of the ones that are working out today, I mean, they're the ones that are hitting it hardest, and they're the ones that have this attitude. Like you know, they're gonna bust you up. The men are not that way. They're soft now, really. And again, the fact is, if you look at the animal kingdom, the females are more aggressive, more vicious, because they protect the young. So if you try to mess with the young, the females are just extraordinarily vicious, and no male of the species is gonna mess with the women. Okay, this is in nature, animal kingdom, for instance. Now, the woman is the king. The queen is the king. I mean, so it's the same way the human kingdom. When their backs are up against it, the women are by far the more vicious ones. Ruthless. Very ruthless. So, there is this situation in the world where there's going to be a great deal of ruthlessness. And we're especially men are not really able to deal with that. Okay, our habits that we've been trained in, all that is we're simply not able to deal with a ruthless, vicious woman. We feel we need to be a gentleman in some way. And so this is where the Vajrayogini, Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma come into the picture, because they can deal with it. They don't have any, you know, gentlemanly compunction to that. Oh, I can't do that. I've been trained not to, you know, always defer and, you know, be nice, and you know, as if men are somehow more vicious ones. They're really not. They're pretty docile, actually, unless they're stirred up and scared by women. I mean, you know, warriors, if you talk to some people, the rougher men, they say, you know, why do you do this, etc. You know, he said, hey, you know, it's better than coming home, you know, to my wife and not, you know, she told me to do this. If I come home, don't come home unless you, you know, get whatever I want you to get. And they're way more scared of her than they are of doing something, any man, a fight, doing something tough, whatever it is. They'll mix it up. And actually, throughout history, the men were way more afraid of going back to the women. You know, like running from a battle, then fighting with maces and battle axes, getting their heads chopped off. They'd rather take their chances doing that than go back to the women. By far. So if the women say, go take that castle, we want something in that. And they let the commander and general know, this is what we want. And then he says, hey, troops, you know, we got to take that castle. I command it. They said, what do you mean? Who you command it? Well, you know, the queen commands it. Well, you know, okay, but if you don't take it, the women will make life a living hell for you. You know, they'll cut off your heads. So you go try to take the castle, and you try to save your life doing so. You know, there's honor in war too. So the men realize, hey, look, you know, my queen said to my commander, we got to take this castle, and your queen said that you got to take our castle, and we don't really want to be like bashing each other's heads in, actually. And so, oh, the war's over. Oh, good. You know, friends. We're friends now. Okay. Forgiven. Sorry. You know, and let's have a beer and let's hope we don't have to do that again. That kind of thing. We don't really, you know, men really don't enjoy beating other men up and killing and all this kind of stuff. We don't enjoy it at all. And if it was up to us, we wouldn't do it. We wouldn't do it at all. So the more you get free of the influence, the feminine influence, the less aggressive men become, they actually become less aggressive, less willing to fight. Very true. You get the macho men, inevitably, there's a very aggressive woman behind them. And you get them out free of that woman, and they turn into a puppy dog. You know, it's like, turns out that they're just this meek person. But they're scared. Daylights are scared out of them by their wives, by their mothers, by their grandmothers, by their aunts. You know, some woman, a constellation of them, is scaring the daylights out of them. It says, you got to go out there and fight, you know, for what we want. Absolutely. The macho men are very insecure. And the women manipulate that insecurity to make them try to be very, very, you know, strong and vicious and grab stuff. Yeah. This is how it actually works here in this world. But I don't fear men. I don't fear men at all. I don't go around in fear of men. No way. Because we say, hey, you know, we're not gonna fight. So we're gonna sit down. We're gonna talk about it a little bit and reason this out and figure out what the heck's going on here. And just, you know, there's some, you know, men are not really looking to get into trouble with one another. They're not. And the French have the saying: every crime, make sure you account for the role of the woman in the crime. If you can't solve it, you got to look deeper than just the men involved. You got to find out who are the women involved in this crime, behind the scenes. That's the difficult part of detective work, actually. And this is very true. So you talk about World War II, Nazi Germany. The Fraulein's are very much involved in what happened in World War II. Very, very much involved in how they educated and raised their children and propagandized them as an extension of their own aggression and viciousness and desire to dominate. They thought they were, you know, better than anybody else, and that their children were going to rule the world. And they brought them up this way, especially the men. You have to go out there and extend, you know, our motherland greatness. It was a very pagan thing, actually. Germany became very pagan. And so, yeah, those Fraulein's were bad news. They raised their children with an iron fist. And sent them off to scouting, sent them off to all this training, rigorous training, making sure that they were these, you know, real strong, super athletic, tough young men. And then instilled all this, you know, maudlin patriotism and all this kind of pagan stuff in them. Now, what about these yoga girls, all these Fraulein's here in the modern world? What are they doing there? Well, they're raising their kids, especially their daughters, to feel that they have a right to demand whatever they want to demand, and men have to obey them. This is the programming that have been getting. So we're going to the same sort of programming where it's the women just simply have this extremely sexist, dominant sort of attitude towards men. It's just amazing. I mean, you talk about sexism, it's the worst sexism ever been in this world right now, actually. If you really look at it carefully, it's amazing. They just feel they're superior to men, and they're dominant. And whatever they tell the men to do, men are supposed to do it. That's sexism. Very bad. Yet men are like, act like they're helpless, they're like paralyzed, deer in headlights. They don't know what to do. Now, historically, men have been the one, the custodians of spiritual grace and teaching and example setting, etc. The custodians of it. Now, a lot of women have benefited from this also. But one of the things is you have to keep nepotism out of religion. It's very important. And women have a marked degree towards nepotism, very strong, much stronger than men. Men will say, look, it's my son, but he's got to earn it. The mother will say, no, he's my son. You got to favor him, you see. So you start getting nepotism in religion, and you have lost the grace of God, because it's merit-based. Religion is supposed to be merit-based. Spiritual study is merit-based entirely. It cannot be based on familial connections at all. So you simply cannot allow women to be the custodians of this, because they have this extreme penchant to favor their offspring, their children, their grandchildren, their family. Men do this to some extent, but it's not nearly as bad. It's not nearly as bad. They can be much tougher and say, look, this is merit-based, and we can't make any exceptions, even for my own children. I can't make exceptions for this, no way. But no, it's a different story with the women. So you want to know why men have been the custodians, that's a very good reason why right there. Nepotism will destroy religion. And you get these dynasties. It's the queens and the women that are behind it. They absolutely are. The queen mother, the dowager, the grandmother, these powerful queen bees, they make sure that their children, they fight for these successions. They'll poison whoever they want, whoever they need to get their children on the throne of succession. They're vicious about it. This is how it works here in this world. You have to be, don't be naive. So, yeah, you cannot have that. You cannot have that. It's merit-based, entirely merit-based. It's not who you know. It's how you've practiced. Blood has no bearing on lineage, spiritual lineages. Absolutely not. Now, that doesn't preclude. It doesn't preclude. Like LoNgChenpa's son took over part of his lineage or something, because he was taught and raised and became apparently very, very learned and very, very full of grace and effective. So, yes, it's not something that either precludes. It's just that nepotism cannot creep into the situation. You're either enlightened or you're not. Yeah, right. I mean, you're either abiding in the clear light vision of intrinsic spaciousness, or you're not. And if you're not, you have no business being a lineage holder. None whatsoever. Unless there's nobody around, to do it, which nepotism creeps in again, and they try to destroy any genuine lineage holder so that their children can then say, okay, well, there's nobody around, better my child, so my child gets to be the lineage holder. This is part of it. And anybody who has lived through history knows this, and we've gotten into this insane adulation of women now in this world, that they can do no wrong, as if throughout history they've never done any wrong. Are you kidding? They are such meddlers and saboteurs and manipulators and devious behind the scenes, do everything possible. This has been totally known throughout history, but they're trying to write that out of all the history books and out of our consciousness as if it never happened. So it's not just getting their child in the right spot, it's also getting rid of anybody who stands in their way, like a succession, a royal succession. They'll try to get rid of the ones that stand in the way, through hook or by crook. Hiring somebody, all manipulating situations. It's bizarre, but it is what it is. It is what it is. This is history. And so you have to be aware that the world is not a nice place. It's not really a nice place. And this, the New World Order, of course they'll have some quote-unquote spirituality, but it will be fake spirituality. It'll be a mishmash. And there's a lot of effort to get, you know, power. Of course they'll be powerful. People always want to look for some sort of hope, right? So the peddling of hope will always take place. But in the New World Order, it's peddling a false hope. And so they don't want any real hope around, the power brokers, the queen bees who are pushing for their dominance. They don't want anybody around that threatens their claim to dominance, meaning any real saints around at all. They certainly don't. Because the people say, hey, wait a minute, this real saint, look, they're doing miracles, they're doing this, and they're offering us real hope, and so you don't have any claim to some lineage of spiritual lineage, and so they say, what they're thinking, if I just get rid of all the saints, then I can claim that I'm the saint, and people can come worship me, and I can get all the power and the goodies and all this kind of stuff that I think will make me happy, and I'll be able to raise my arrogance level way up. Now, this is just spiritual politics that's happening in the world. It's always happening. Never stops here in this world, spiritual politics. But there's another twist to the whole thing here. And I'm talking about all this because the event horizon on May 27th is coming up just a few days now. Fires of materialism are about ready to start burning. No question about it. The goal is to get rid of the saints. Meaning those who are spiritually literate, very spiritually literate, because they have the capacity to become saints for sure, and they will. Those who are adept at praying, they want to get rid of them. They want to get rid of all of that. So that means you and I are certainly targeted, absolutely. At least in their purpose now. We can protect ourselves, take refuge, absolutely. But it has to be very, very strong refuge. Because we have a set of yoga girl fraulein, Amazon frauleins here, that they are very ruthless. This is my impression. Very ruthless indeed. Very kind of odd, too. Their personas are very odd. It's almost as if, they're not normal. You might put it that way. And they don't care what happens to men at all. Not at all. Men are disposable, plain and simple. But I'm not disposable. Okay, this is my viewpoint. I'm not disposable. Because spiritual literacy is completely essential to our salvation. And momentum and confidence is super important to gain spiritual literacy. If we lose our spiritual confidence, if we lose our faith in the spiritual path and the grace of God, we are in an extremely bad situation. Now, a lot of people say, you know, much of life is confidence, which is very true, actually. It is very true. You lose your confidence, and you're in a dark pit here. I lost my confidence, so I know what that's like, and you feel like Humpty Dumpty. You can't put it back together again. You cannot. It's super difficult. You lose your confidence in your spiritual connection, your intuition, your spiritual voice within you. You lose confidence in all of that. You're a lost soul. And then you're very easily manipulated into being violent, into doing whatever the yoga girls want you to do. You're very easily manipulated. You're desperate. You're very insecure. So their goal is to ruin our confidence. So they don't want anyone around who gives you spiritual confidence, that really instills spiritual confidence in you. They don't want them them around. So they can destroy the confidence we have in prayer, for instance, for when you pray, you look for corroboration, right, of the prayer. And I get it all the time. When I pray, you're aware, okay, I expect a response of some sort from the grace of God. And it happens. It absolutely happens. Sometimes very fast, sometimes slower. But these days, it seems to come very fast. Especially if I ask LOngchenpa for some help, it comes extremely fast. So you build up through a lifetime of prayer and response and corroboration. You build up faith in the grace of God, and then this is confidence. You build confidence, and confidence then propels you very fast along the path. So it's essential to build up this confidence, and you can only build it up bit by bit by bit by bit by miracles, by answers to your prayers, through inner experiences, through dreams, through others telling you the responses they got through prayer. So you're supposed to share your stories of, I prayed for help in this, and this is what happened. So you're supposed to tell one another about your life of prayer and miracles. This is the way society is supposed to be structured, so that you gain confidence in the grace of God, so that you rely on it more and more. Because in order to get free from our arrogance, and this whole dream is just a dream of arrogance, we need help. We really need help. We need the grace of God, because our arrogance simply says, well, God doesn't matter, because I just say that God doesn't exist anymore. And so you can't leave arrogance. It's impossible. This is the trouble with arrogance. It just thinks that whatever it says is true. And it's very intimidating. We've intimidated ourselves. We've frightened ourselves, actually. So the grace of God, God gave the Holy Spirit to us, the grace of God, to help us set arrogance down. And we have to do that. And in order to do that, we have to have a lot of faith, a lot of confidence to do that. Otherwise, the continuity fear is too severe. So you need, society has to be structured in a way that we pray and we share the responses to prayer with one another, so we gain confidence. And by prayer, I mean skillful means. It's not just, you know, Judeo-Christian prayer, but it's also the skillful means of other traditions. There's lots of different ways to ask for God's help. Lots of different ways. There's lots of different practices that you can do. So we're supposed to share that information with one another, okay? That's civilization, actually. As Ramaharshi said, the only purpose of our life here is to turn within and find the self and realize the self. That's it. That's the only purpose. So this is the purpose of civilization, to build up spiritual confidence. What has happened here in the world now is a massive attack on our spiritual confidence, where you feel like people call you crazy if you start talking about prayer and miracles and response, and so you don't share anymore. So they've prevented people from sharing, by and large. They've prevented people from praying in school, certainly publicly. You don't see public prayer anymore. Like I said, I never see anyone pray in public anymore. I'm like the only one I see who does that. At before meals, we'll pray in public. Nobody else does it. Not one. There's only like one person I know that shares. They're telling me about their prayer experiences and their responses. It's almost vanished, extinct. They've almost made it extinct, except, you know, in some churches that they're still, but it's been watered down to most places. There's some that are still holding on, but society in general, the civilization, the culture, it's been virtually eradicated. And if you understand the purpose of our life here, you will know that that's the wrong direction to go in, for sure. And that you should encourage public prayer. You should encourage sharing of miracles. You should structure that into politics, into bureaucracy, into everything. You should encourage people putting up reminders of God's grace in whatever way. I mean, if it's Islam, it would be calligraphy or ornamentation, because they don't use human figures. Other traditions will use figures of Buddha or Jesus, the saints, or, you know, various deities, meditational deities in Hinduism, and, you know, on and on and on. But those should be in public places, prominently displayed, to remind us, oh yeah, I'm supposed to pray. I'm supposed to expect response to the prayer. I'm supposed to tell others about the positive responses I got. And this ultimately builds up enough faith so you can do these practices and call upon the help of God's grace in such a manner that it you're literally able to shift your attention from sensory perception to the clear light vision of intrinsic spaciousness. Okay, you're literally able to shift. And when you shift that way, then you see, oh my gosh, this whole sensory body thing is a total mirage delusion. Coming from arrogance, designed to deceive myself. That's all it is. And you realize that it's, you know, you see it, you recognize it, and then you're liberated. You know, you abide in the alpha clear light vision of intrinsic spaciousness. This is your perceptual base, and you still see trees and everything else, but you realize that they're not. They're just ornamentation of intrinsic spaciousness, and that's all there is. And it's a spontaneous arising in the now. You see it clear with a clear light vision of intrinsic spaciousness. So ultimately, the whole goal of our civilization is supposed to get us so we feel confident enough to shift into a clear light vision of intrinsic spaciousness. This is the whole goal, the entire civilization, the purpose of our life here. That is our purpose. And we don't have any other purpose, actually. So humanism and materialism is seeking to destroy spiritual confidence in the world, eradicate prayer, eradicate sharing of miracles, all of this. And they have gone a long ways towards this, actually. A very long ways. To the extent that I feel like an outcast here, and like I can't witness to anybody. I feel like people look at me like there's something severely wrong with me. So I feel very nervous about that because I really want to. It's like you want to do something, but you feel if you do, you're going to get in trouble. It's that kind of nervousness. It's really terrible here. It's atrocious, actually. It's atrocious. Absolutely atrocious. They're basically trying to eradicate Christian Science, for instance. Pretty much have done so, right? Which was a great, great movement of high spiritual literacy, extremely helpful, extremely important and helpful in our culture, in our traditions and history, Christian Science, New Thought, Christian Science, New Thought came out of Christian Science, basically, which was very high spiritual literacy. And there were a tremendous number of miracles took place and healings there. Astonishing. And the people were shared them and talked about them. Where has that gone? Well, I went into a Christian Science reading room a while back, and the whole place is being run by radical feminists. And they said the whole purpose, Mary Baker, was support feminism. Women are supposed to be in charge and rule men. And, you know, we're the ones supposed to be telling everybody what to do. The whole spirit was absolutely gone. It had been taken over, like by Nazis. It was like a Nazification of Christian Science, actually. It's like, wow. That was quite some time ago. That was like 15, 20 years ago or something. It was quite some time ago, yeah. Imagine what it is now. I don't want to think about it. Well, they've pretty much, you know, made laws now where if any healing doesn't work, you know, you're liable for a crime. You know, they just really crushed it. The pharmaceutical industry has crushed Christian Science. Materialism has crushed it, tried to a large extent, right? Yeah, they had the right idea, actually. That they saw you as perfect. There's nothing wrong. You're absolutely perfect. You're flawless. You don't have any illness whatsoever. You're exactly as God created you. You're just pretending. It's just a pretense that you're sick. And I see you. I affirm that it's okay with me that you're completely well from this without any need to establish your wellness. You're inherently well from this. So there's no process needed for you to be well. You simply can drop the illness and just let it vanish. There's various ways they worked on this. They worked at the level of the mind, which was the correct level to work on. And they worked on a level that basically you're already perfect. You're already liberated. There's no real sickness in you whatsoever. That's the correct way to work at it. It's the correct way. So how far have we fallen with the humanists and the pharmaceutical industry and the healthcare industry, the greediness there of wanting everybody to be sick so they can milk us like cash cows. They don't want people going around and say, guess what? You're just pretending to be sick. Oh, like, hey, Lazarus, get out of the grave. You're just pretending to be dead. Lazarus goes, oh, yeah, you're right, Jesus. Do you think they want that? No, they want to eradicate that. And I do mean eradicate it. And the yoga girls are the new high priestesses and goddesses of the healthcare industry in the New World Order, and they're the ones who you know want to be in control than they are. They feel they can do a better job at it, and yeah, they're more vicious. Of course, they can. When you want to institute a ruthless tyranny, that's who you call on. And of course, they want nepotism. They hate merit-based situations. They want nepotism. Why? So their children can get in super powerful positions, and when they get old, they can still have all this power. You know, it's like, hey, my son's got to be a doctor. You know, use all this guilt trip on him to make sure they're a lawyer or a doctor. Why? So mom, you know, they can buy mom a house and have her live in the lap of luxury the last 40, 30, 40 years of her life, right? And take care of all her medical expenses and everything. Of course, they want nepotism. And women tend to outlive men by a large margin. And they're very, very keen about their health care and their life. Men don't plan so much about their old age. A lot of them don't. I never even give it a thought. I've never given a thought. If I do, I freak out because I haven't planned for it at all. But women are very much plan for it, very meticulous at it, because they think, well, I'm going to live to be about 95. And so the last 5 years of my life, I might have to be in assisted care living. But I want to go cruising from age 60 to 90. I want to have 30 years of cruising the world and vacations and living, you know, great, the high life and go out, you know. So they plan their life like this. A lot of them tend not to do that. And for me, I have not even planned. I don't even plan tomorrow. I don't plan anything, really. Except to just work on spiritual literacy and try to be helpful. So, of course they want nepotism. And the whole thing about the spiritual culture is that there is no nepotism. It's merit-based. So women have a vested interest in getting rid of that. A lot of them do. There's a lot of great women, too, in the world. There's no question about it. Saw a couple today, you know, these yoga girls exercising. There's a couple of older women, they're just like, they're so mellow and calm and dressed so appropriately, and it's just like, it's just like night and day. Their attitude is completely different. It's not like I'm going to dominate you attitude or something. No, it's like, you know, let's live and let live, walk along together, and that's okay, you know, like that. It's very different. Night and day kind of feeling. It's amazing. Ah, holy cow. And I was at this grocery store. There's another little note here from the day. And this yoga girl's ahead of me. I mean, this was an aggressive woman. Wow. You just feel like bristling the aggression. It's like, I'm in a hurry. Get out of my way. I'm the one who makes the rules here, guys, you know. And she went out the door, you know. Okay, go. I'm in a hurry. And the guy said, oh, what do I do with her receipt? He's a trainee. He says, she left her receipt. What do I do? And the guy that who was training him said, no, don't worry. Just throw it away. He says, happens all the time. And I said, what? What do you mean? Are you kidding me? He said, no. He says, you know what? About 4 out of 10 don't even take their receipts. They're in too. I said, why? They're in too much of a hurry. He says, yeah. I said, well, they're saving what? 5 seconds? 10 seconds? I don't know. And he says, yeah. I mean, well, 10 seconds to them, you know, that's 10 seconds lost forever if they spend it that way, you know. And I said, whoa, you know, sometimes it's good to slow down and make less mistakes and, you know, make haste slowly. And there's two guys, and they totally agree with me. They said, you know, that's exactly how I feel. You know, this crazy of like every second, you know, sometimes when you're that way, you actually slow things get. Like my work, I have to pace myself. I said, don't go too fast because I know someone's going to call me. If I go too fast, I'll have to turn around and backtrack and stuff. So you have to realize, you have to be intuitive about your life. But these Uber tech, you know, and the yoga girls of this kind, it's like, forget the receipt. I got to go out of here. I got, you know, I'm up, get out of my way. And then, you know, woman just about ran me over. She's too busy to look. too busy to look, too much of a hurry to look. What are they such a hurry about? Money, greed, a lot of things. Nepotism. We're in a hurry because we got to get rid of religion and spirituality. I mean, materialists think happiness comes from material luxury and comfort. So they want, you know, three houses. They want vacations all around the world. They want new cars every couple of years. They want, you know, just they want to live in the lap, be pampered, lap of luxury. If they think that that's the only way they can ever be happy, so they are absolutely vicious to get the money. Very greedy, very ruthless. They demand that their children be that way, so that, you know, they get, you know, mom gets the benefits of all that. They push their children so severe, the children commit suicide. The helicopter moms, I mean, it's brutal here in the Silicon Valley. Just brutal. The kids are on so many medications, it's unbelievable, because the mothers never stop. Their whole lives are already structured, totally structured, super competitive. You got to get into here. 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 I'm only doing this for your benefit. And the kid says, "You're killing me. What do you mean my own benefit? What about my life?" Now she wants the kids to be quote unquote successful, so she has wonderful grandchildren and lots of money coming in from, you know, and her life is wonderful life, wonderful materialistic life. So, but there's this coalition. There's other factors to that's just one factor. But it's the most dangerous factor. Because these women are training themselves to not take no for an answer. It's a funny thing, huh? Back in the day, 70s, it was all about, hey, you have to take our no for an answer, right? That was feminism, that, you know, that the whole idea is no means no. So when a woman says no, you know, that's it. You have to take no for an answer, even though there's all sorts of other circumstances going on, quote unquote. But that's the law, that's the rule. So how about the flip it around? What if the man says no? Does a woman have to take that no as an answer? Well, these days, absolutely not. They can completely disregard it, actually. What recourse do men have, actually? They don't have any. Not really. So basically, when they say, do something, we say no, they say, well, I heard your no, but do it anyway. Because if you don't, this and this and this and this is going to happen to you. Well, how is that any different than the flip side? Whereas a man pressuring a woman, as you say no, so if you say no, this and this is going to happen to you. Right? Well, so how come what's good for the goose is not good for the gander? It's complete hypocrisy going on here. And again, extreme sexism is going on here. So you put it all together, and then there's the contingent where, you know, people shy away from this entirely. But I'm one who has never shied away from this, because I have very direct experience with all of this, is the extraterrestrial coercion and bullying that's happening here on this planet. We're being bullied by extraterrestrials. Very severely, we've been severely bullied by them because we didn't know how to stand up to them. Just like a man doesn't know how to stand up to a woman these days, humanity didn't know how to stand up to the extraterrestrials, except for the very spiritual ones who had the protection of Christ or Buddha mind or whatever, you know. They could. But other than that, we really were caught for a loss, you know. But we were sold short by the leaders. They say, well, the people will be panicked. No, I'm sure the Christians would have been able to stand up to him pretty well, right? But we weren't given a chance, lied to the whole time. Religious people around the world actually have tools to stand up to the extraterrestrials. And I've had many, many encounters with them in the subtle levels and know what bullies they are, actually. They're very, very intense bullies. But you can stand up to them. You absolutely can. But you have to practice it, and you have to feel that you have the right to do so. And if somebody says you're crazy, if you even talk about ETs, you're going to think, well, that undermines your confidence. But if people say, yeah, of course they're ETs here, and of course they're bullies, and of course they have an agenda, and of course they're quote-unquote helping us out by reverse engineering some of their technology, some of the cheaper stuff that not so important. But they have an agenda for this world. They have an agenda. It's their agenda that they want here. They want this to be a hedonistic, humanistic paradise for them in a command and control center, a strategic colony, so to speak, a strategic colony. It's kind of similar to the colonialists, getting certain islands and taking over certain areas because it was strategically important for their greed to go into other countries and pull all the wealth out of them, right? Which is, of course, what they did. Rape the country, rape the land, take everything valuable, and just leave it destitute, environmentally pillaged, etc. But hey, who cares? They're living in materialistic comfort back at home, Rule Britannica. Who cares if people in India are starved to death because you had them grow cash crops, opium. As long as we're, ladies at home or have their tea, pepper and tea, what? Let them eat cake. I mean, we're happy. Why can't they be happy? Well, because they starved to death. That's why. Well, that's not our problem, I don't want to think about it, Let me go shop and buy a new dress. Make me feel better. That'll make me feel better. I feel better already. Get some new teapot and some cutlery and so whatever, and just keep on going materialistically getting more, build up the arrogance even more. They think that'll make us happy. Of course, that's what arrogance says, right? More arrogance will make you happy. That's what it always says. So, just like that, the ETs have a reason for, quote-unquote, helping us out. It's like colonialists coming to India and say, hey, we came here to give you some of these beautiful glass beads and this glassware and stuff. And the Indians go, wow, you did? Yeah. Oh, thank you so much. White man, very nice. These beautiful glass beads. My wife really loves these. She wants a necklace of them. So what do you, he says, well, sure, we'll give your wife as many necklaces as you want. All you got to do is give us all this land and all the legal rights to it. They say, legal rights? What's that? He says, well, don't worry, we'll draw papers. You just sign here, make your mark, and you're good to go. And then he says, okay, I just got to make my fingerprint and mark. Okay, great. And, got the glass, the bead necklaces. My wife's so happy. She thinks she's so beautiful. Brings some mirrors, she can look in the mirror now. It's like, wow. My wife's never been so happy. I'm her hero now, and what do you mean? I can't go to my hunting ground over there. What? No. We own this now. You can't go there. It's our property. What? What are you talking about? Well, it's okay. You can still go that one over there. We don't own that one yet. Oh, huh? That's kind of funny. I don't quite understand that. And now, of course, they've got the reservations they can go on, right? And so, history's all around us. And you got to be an idiot not to put two and two together, really. But people are idiots because they're blinded by the false light of materialism and arrogance. I mean, the devastation of history is all around us. And there's causes for that. There's reasons for it. There's trends for it. It's materialism, folks. It's materialism. Secular, humanistic materialism is the reason for it. And, of course, they spend all their time pointing the finger at religion, blaming religion for everything. But keep in mind, it was the secular, humanistic habits of those who were converted to religion, that those habits were still there, that causes the problem in religion. It's not the religion that causes the problem. It's the bad habits of those who are trying to work on those. We get rid of those habits. That's the problem. So you're hardly going to make it better by turning back to those habits and trying to make them even stronger. That's just like delay, and you have to go through the whole doggone thing again all over again. It's just totally stupid what's happening here. So the fruits of religion are slow to come because you have to undo these habits and get good habits. But they do come. I mean, there's been a lot of fruits of religion throughout history. We are just getting a completely distorted picture of it from the media and from the modern tech society. I mean, it's just, I mean, they have like zero interest. They have a lot of interest in getting rid of it. Man, because they want to run everything on algorithms, their software and their microchips, and sell this and, you know, power. This is, we're so smart. We're so arrogant. This is great. They don't want to ask, you know, Manjushri for help, Holy Spirit for help, Vajrasattva for help, you know, LOngchenpa for help, Jesus Christ for help, Ramana Maharshi for help, and Sri Sri Anandamayi, Vajrayogini for help. You know, they don't want to repent and say, look, I have a terrible habit of arrogance. I really need help. Can you please, you know, cut my attachments off to this and you know, humble me and stuff. No. They don't want to do that. Are you kidding me? They want to go and get some better wine. So these materialists are bad news, folks. They are hideous news. They always have been throughout history. And women run the pagan ship. They're the captains of the pagan ship. They always have been. You know, they push their, get out there, you know, general, you know, get out in front there, and, you know, you can command the loyalty of the men, you know, but this is what we want you to do, basically. Absolutely. They structure it in a way so that it's kind of camouflaged, you know, they're very clever at camouflage. All of nature is very clever at camouflage, actually. And there's, you know, there's a lot of gallant men throughout history who trying to win the love of lady love, you know, the courtly love, the gallant knights, you know, go off to the crusade because the lady love says, I will be waiting here for you, but you can't have my love until you come back and liberate the Holy Land. This is all important. Well, yeah, it's important for their wealth, trade routes and everything else. Right? So they can get more materialistic comfort. So, yeah, go off like gallant hero knight and go slay, you know, the infidel. And so I can live a more prosperous life, yeah. But don't come back unless you're successful. So there's lots of gallant knights that would go galloping off for that. But we all know how it works here. If for some reason, we've been petrified right now. Petrified by the gadgets, because it's like we're afraid, like, I mean, what, maybe they could take these gadgets away from us, you know, if we don't behave, the ETs, if we don't behave the way we want to. And the ETs love the pagan society. That's what they want. It's easy to control because people aren't asking for miracles, you see, because miracles can snap the bands of control of the extraterrestrials here, and they don't want that at all. That's what they're terrified. They're terrified of Jesus Christ, the extraterrestrials. Just check it out. Just try it out. Just invoke the name of the Dharma kings and say that they're protected. And just see, why does Tibetan Buddhism have these ferocious protectors of the Dharma? Because that's to scare off the ETs and the demons. Why did Padmasambhava, they brought him in to get rid of the demons? Well, those are subtle dimensional entities that were controlling Tibet. Padmasambhava got rid of them. They didn't like that. LOngchenpa got rid of the Naga, you know, this Naga snake that was causing problems and other stuff. They're able to liberate us from these very noxious influences. Extraterrestrial, extra-dimensional, various dynamics that want to just use us for their own arrogance and materialistic uses. So the last thing the ETs want is anyone, any miracles being done there, anyone invoking miracles in the name of Jesus Christ. This, I protect myself. I claim protection. I give empowerment and permission for my protection from the grace of God. In the name of Jesus, amen. That's the last thing they want to hear. It scares the heck out of them. They're furious about it. They want to eradicate it. They want to eradicate it. and they'll replace it with their own, you know, quote unquote, spirituality, religion, blah, 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 blah stuff. But it's all been caponized, you know, it's all been completely crippled. So it doesn't have any juice to stand up to them at all. In fact, the whole religion is based around serving them. Like our whole purpose is to serve you, yes. So a lot of radical feminists believe that the whole purpose of men is to worship and serve women. That's right. That's right. And they even have said so much. They even proclaim that, like they're proclaiming the gospel truth to the world. The purpose of men is to adore, worship, and serve women. And they're just preparing men for the extraterrestrials, actually. So they can get materialistic benefits from having prepared them in the extraterrestrials. Say, wow, what a great job do you do. And let's keep you in a high position here so we keep them under control. And so they've already cozied up to the ETs. Some of the yoga girls have cozied up to the ETs already. That started in, the 80s, late 70s, 80s. Massive amount of women cozied up to the extraterrestrials. They found out they were here because psychically they became aware of them in various ways. And they started cozying up to him, jumping in bed with him. Absolutely they did. Millions and millions and millions. And they became the yoga girls of today who have this very strong relationship with extraterrestrials on subtle levels and are helping them take over the world. Get rid of miracles. Get rid of prayer. Okay? Get rid of invoking the grace of God and the help of the grace of God. That's got to go. And the yoga girl says, we're in charge of religion now. We'll decide what the church says, what religion says. They're absolutely aiming for that. They're aiming for a lot of stuff. They're aiming to collapse our spiritual confidence here. So, enter Vajra Yogini. Enter Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma. You might say they could be one and the same. Because this enters into the picture now because of the severe crisis that we're in. Do you really think Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma wants to see us lose our spiritual confidence? That's the last thing she would possibly want to see happen. And we just have to have faith in this. I know it's difficult. It's difficult for me because, you know, it's hard. You hope to get, you know, where are the troops? Where's the help? You know, it seems like, what are they waiting for? you just have to have faith. You know that. How much? I have 28. Okay, I have a lot of space. That's the last thing they want is us to lose our spiritual confidence. That's a disaster for them. So you've got to believe that they're going to do something very, very strong to help us. Okay? You have to believe this. I believe this. I don't know exactly when it will happen or how it will happen or what, but literally, they could just take us to a different place than this world if it comes to that. I believe they would take that step. If that's what it takes to protect our spiritual confidence, I believe they will do it. That's why Jesus said he would come back at the end of the age and he'll take us to a place he's prepared for us. Jesus, again, the last thing Jesus Christ wants is for us to lose our spiritual confidence. This is, at all costs, he wants to avoid that for us. And we're thinking, oh, Jesus, you know, we're getting crushed here. I mean, really? I mean, why don't you step in and do so? Well, we don't know. He may be waiting so we see how severe it is before he steps in. He's here already, but he hasn't taken action yet. But he may be waiting until we finally say, oh, my God, we're in big trouble. And this may come about by July 24th, I'm told, is spiritual people may realize, uh-oh, we're being targeted. We really are. They really mean business here. They really mean to crush our spiritual confidence and say, no. If we have to go to another dwelling place, we will go, plain and simple. Too bad, ETs. You're not, how would you put it? You don't have the power to stop us. Let's put it that way. You do not have the power to stop us. So, deal with it. That's how it goes down. And for their benefit, they realize, wow, huh, maybe arrogance isn't where it's at. So these great teachers absolutely have the capacity to lift us into some other dwelling place. They absolutely have the capacity. Piece of cake for them. Nothing to it. They absolutely have the capacity to create living places for us. Piece of cake for them. In an instant. In an instant. Do it in an instant, actually. They may, I don't know, they may spend a great deal of prayer and creativity into it or something. I don't know. But their mind is capable of actually having a universe, whole universe appear instantaneously, or many universes appear instantaneously, actually. So it could certainly have dwelling places appear instantaneously. It's you know, desire it, and it's done. So again, spiritual confidence in miracles and prayer, and the efficaciousness of prayer, in the widest sense of prayer. It could be a mantra, Tibetan Buddhist mantra. It could be any sort of, you know, practice, Mahamudra practice or Anatta Yoga practice or Chakra Samara, Samara practice, or how they say it, you know, any Zen Buddhist, Zen thing practice, Jewish practice, Kabbalah practice, you know, on and on and on and on and on, mysticism practice of various traditions. There's innumerable practices, actually. There's actually infinite, really. There's all sorts of ways that we can focus our intent. It's just focusing our intent and our will and confidence. There's lots of different ways. And this gives us confidence in prayer, in miracles, and of course we need spiritual intuition to see the responses, because our concretized mind says, ah, that could be a lot of different explanations for that. It's just a coincidence, just a coincidence. I say, yeah, but this, all coincidences? Yeah, sure. Really? That sounds to me like some kind of extreme religious faith to say they're all coincidences. That seems like some blind faith that it's all coincidence. No. When you get a constellation that arises like this, you realize that can't possibly be mere coincidence. There has to be some sort of orchestration behind the scenes we call the grace of God. And you build up your faith, but only if you have the spiritual eyes and intuition and trust in it, and stop sabotaging yourself. What this secular humanistic culture does is it sabotages us, teaches us to be self-saboteurs. Not to trust in ourselves. Now, we had a problem in the hospital. We didn't trust in ourselves. I said, this is what we should do. We both believe this is what we should do. We changed our mind at the last moment because all the pressure from doctors, etc., from secular humanists saying this is what we should do, and then just about lost, you know, lost a life. It's a terrible situation. Still remains very difficult. Because God told us to do one thing, and the secular humanists told us to do is another. And we were so intimidated by it. You know, that you feel like you just can't speak up right now. So it really, literally cost you your life now. That's how bad it is. And I've already experienced this in my own experiencing here, is it almost cost a life. Without tremendous prayers and help, it would have cost a life, actually. Absolutely. I had to do tremendous amount of prayers, a tremendous amount of prayers that were in play here, and it saved a life. And without that, no, it wouldn't have gone right at all. There's no question about it. The wheels would have come off, would have lost a precious life. And so would have lost the life of someone who believes in prayer and believes in miracles, you know? They could have gotten rid of them. Yeah, you know, in the morgue, and you know, that happens, you know. No, I was aware that there this the And spiritual people understand that the spiritual warfare is going on. If they can butcher you in a hospital and claim it's a mistake, they will do so. And I'm aware of this. So this is why I had to bring such intense prayer. I prayed to LongChenpa so much, and he showed up big time. St. Jude showed up. St. Paul showed up. There are many, many saints and helpers that showed up there and showed, don't worry, we got your back. You'll get out, you know, they'll get out of this hospital alive. It was tremendous, tremendous display of protection that took place there. And it was needed. It was needed. I don't want to go in a hospital. I'm, you know, afraid I would never come out alive. I mean, these secular humanist doctors, you know, they're controlled by their ideology of the ego, by their arrogance. And the whole scene in the hospitals is healthcare is a new religion, the new world order. And they don't want competition from Jesus and from miracles, not at all. So if they can, you know, strike a blow for their side, you know, yeah, why not? Why not take the opportunity to do so? And we think, oh no, the Hippocratic Oath protects. No, it doesn't protect against malpractice and sloppiness and error here and error there, and it all compounds itself, doesn't it? Oh, they had many pre-existing conditions, and the loss of blood triggered the heart attack. Well, you know, it was a pre-existing, they look, do an autopsy. Oh, you see, there was a blockage in the heart. Okay, well, that was, you know, there's nothing you can do about that, and they're dead. But see, it didn't work out that way, the way that they wanted to work out. LoNgchenpa, you know, and his array of bodhisattvas and dakinis, and Jesus Christ and his array of saints, and Ramana Maharshi, okay, and Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma, and all of the prayers of friends, etc. That all added up, and we walked out of their life. But it hasn't been an easy path since then. A lot of damage was done. So this is just an example of not trusting, not feeling that we can stand up for ourselves anymore, because clearly I got clear indications that this is what we should do, and don't give them the opportunity to butcher you. You know, and God's grace told us this is the right way to go. But the secular humanists, you know, start arguing, saying, no, you're crazy if you do that. You're really stupid if you do that. That's really foolish to do that. I'm going to be really mad if you do this. So we got put under all this pressure from, you know, family, friends, doctors, you know, all these authority figures telling you, you got to do this. Well, no, we didn't. In hindsight, it was a mistake. So all those doctors are mistaken. All those people are mistaken, actually. But they'll never admit it. And if you try to confront them with it, they'll think you're just an arrogant, you know, SOB lunatic, and you should be on medication, right? They will. This is the situation we're in. So it's a life-threatening situation. I've already experienced this now in my life. It was a life-threatening situation. Only miracles saved us. Only miracles saved us. Someone named Paul saved a life there. And he was super intent on doing so. He was like divinely inspired. I mean, he was just amazing. He was so determined. He says, I'm not going to let this person die. I am not going to let them die. There's going to be a way to keep them alive. So there's a lot of miracles that took place there. We're taught to that we can pray. What do you pray? Well, pray is stupid. Pray for rain. Pray for, oh yeah, that's really, wow, what idiots. You know, science tells us, you know, we've gone beyond that. Wow, these people are really dumb because they didn't get an education. No, it's that the other people got a miseducation. Keep in mind that this is all a dream. It's all pretense. So, sure, we can pretend in a certain way that it seems like there's scientific facts taking place. But they're not real facts at all. They're not real facts at all. We can always pretend otherwise if we want to. Jesus said, Lazarus, get up from the grave. You're just pretending. Well, science would say that's impossible. Because all these facts, the heart stopped, the breathing stopped, the brain, you know, was damaged, blah, 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 blah. So it's impossible, they say. And yet, Christians will say, no, it's not impossible because Lazarus rose from the grave. Jesus rose a number of people from the dead, right? What was it? Might have been, what, four? Something like that? There's a dead daughter, a dead son or something. There's various people who were dead. And Jesus raised them from the dead. But especially Lazarus, who was like dead 3 days or something. Right? They said, don't roll the stone away. He's rotting. It'll be terrible. Jesus says, roll the stone away. Lazarus, come out. I know you're in there. You can't hide from me. I know you're in there. And Lazarus walked out in the burial cloth. Says, Jesus, go put your clothes on and get back, you know, get back into life, get in the swing of things. Lazarus said, okay. He was pretending. We're all pretending. All, like Jesus says, all death is suicide. But really, it's all pretense. There's no death at all. We're just pretending to die. We're pretending we're a body. We're pretending the body dies. We're pretending all of this. This is the power of the mind, okay? We think, how's that possible? The mind is amazing. Okay, the mind is stupendously amazing. It is, it's simply, our imagination cannot comprehend it. We cannot comprehend it through our imagination. From our perspective, we cannot really comprehend the creativity and capability of the mind. It's all powerful, all capable, except it can't change what it is. So it can pretend, easily pretend to be dead. Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma did it on occasions. She said, "You want me to be dead?" Because people are acting like, "Wow, why do we want her around? We don't have any use for her." And she goes, "Oh, okay." She realized that really they want her to be dead. She goes, "Okay, no problem, I'll be dead." And she'd drop at their feet and turn into a rotting corpse right in front of their faces, because it's all pretense. So she said, "Okay, I'll pretend to be dead. I'll pretend to be a rotting corpse for you, because that's what you want." And then they would be so struck by anguish, they said, okay, we will utilize you for what you came here for. We'll make greater efforts. We'll practice. We'll get with it here. And so we do want you here." And then, you know what? Boom, she'd return to perfect health, just like that. All pretense. It's all pretense. This is true. I say this over and over again because it's absolutely witnessed by extremely credible people. And their life was such that there's no reason to say that these people, this did not happen. It's absolute pretense. So many, 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 many miracles. You can't count them all. You could write book after book after book after book after book of all the miracles that she did. You know, just like nothing to her. It's all pretense, folks. I mean, you're just making all this up. It's all pretense. It's all God. Everything's perfect. You know, we're just pretending otherwise. That's all. So whatever needs to happen, it can happens. That's it. That's all. It's no big deal to her at all. Not at all. Because she's totally aware it was all completely pretense. 100%. So do you think the pharmaceutical companies want us to realize it's all pretense? You think the reptilians want us to realize it's all pretense? Are you kidding? They want more arrogance is what they want. They don't want miracles. They want arrogance. So Jesus came back and he said, "A course in miracles, folks. A course in miracles." Okay? That's what he emphasizes, is miracles. Which is the Holy Spirit. Grace of God, the Holy Spirit, collapsing time, collapsing our honoring of time. We decide, okay, I decide I don't need to honor time very much in this way anymore, and the Holy Spirit will collapse then that time for us, and we're free of honoring in that way. So if we say, "Well, you know, I don't really want to be sick anymore, the sickness, I don't want to honor time through this sickness, so I'm through with that, so Holy Spirit, would you please help me drop this time and drop this pretense," and you know, miracles come, and you just recover. Just, you know, like, "Oh, wow, I got better." It might take a little while because we don't want to totally collapse time yet. So, but we get well. Cancer disappears. Just like that. The broken limb is fixed. The chopped off finger is put back on the fan, and everything's fine. There's a man named Christopher Hills here in Scotts Valley area, Santa Cruz Mountain area. He wrote a bunch of yoga books. Interesting guy, quite spiritually literate. I think his son's thumb got cut off or something like that, and he went into this spiritual state so strong, they just reattached it, and it was fine. It was just fine. He did a number of miracles like that, and he talked about it. Yeah. Yeah, these yogis, they chop their arm off. You know, they just, you know, take the other and just put it back on their body, because it's all pretense. We're just pretending. There's even this deity in Hinduism, Chinmasti or something like that. Headless, you know, she's holding her head in her hands, and just walking around with her head in her hands. I think there's stories of yogis having their head chopped off and they just keep walking. You know, they pick up their head and just carry it and sit down, you know, in yoga posture with their head in their hands. And then the people freak out so bad. They go, "What's the matter?" They can't say that, but they can mentally, telepathically, they can make the people think they're saying it. So why are you so scared? Well, you're walking around with your head in your hands. "Oh, that scared you? Oh, you want me to put my head back on?" Yeah. Okay. So they lift their head back on, put it back on, and everything's fine. Like nothing happened. And the people go, "Oh, my gosh. I think I better pay attention to what you have to say." I don't recommend this. I'm not claiming any such capabilities at this point. Don't test me out. Don't test anyone out on this one. But historically, these things have happened, and they certainly can happen. As again, I say, Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma had this cancer because she took on karma of cancer to mellow it out, so to speak, for some reason. And again, she was metastasized, so the doctor says the worst case of cancer I've ever seen. I don't know how you've been alive. You must be in the most incredible pain possible. It's just tumors everywhere in your body. This is just absolutely hideous. I can't take it. Please take morphine. Please take morphine. It's just, I'm just distraught. You know, I'm a doctor. I got to help, you know, you're suffering. I got to cut the pain. That's my job. I got to cut the pain. She goes, what pain? I'm not feeling any pain. The doctor says, well, you must be in the most terrible pain imaginable. You know, everything's strangulated. The tumors have strangulated all your systems. It's just everywhere. And she says, oh, no, I'm fine. I'm fine. I feel great. I feel blissful as always. What are you talking about, doc? So the doc left and she was sleeping. He said, you're going to be dead by the morning. She says, well, we'll see. We'll see. Whatever will be, will be. So the doc snuck down at midnight, you know, in the middle of the night with a morphine syringe full of some kind of opiate morphine or something. And he thought he was going to, while she was sleeping, he was going to stick it in her and, you know, fill her up with morphine just so at least she wouldn't be in agony while she died. And when he went to her room, she was like sitting upright in some yoga posture like this. And he stopped. He said, oh, what the heck's going on? He was like, I guess he was in the shadows or darkness. He was looking. And suddenly he saw this bright light flash. Just the whole room was just brilliantly illuminated by this tremendous flash of light. And he saw some sort of figure seem to leap through the window and run away and by the Ganges River or something. And he fled in terror. He was just shocked by the whole thing. And then he came in the morning to see if she was still alive. And she was like busy working and doing meeting with people and everything. And I said, what the heck's going on? And then he examined her and there wasn't a trace of cancer in her body, completely gone. And she smiled and said, doc, you know, what's the matter? He said, well, you're no cancer. He said, yeah. And he said, what happened? Well, it left me last night. Early this morning it left me. It decided to leave. So I said, okay, you know, nice to make your acquaintance. Goodbye, you know, auf Wiedersehen. And it left me. And the doc says, well, that's impossible, but I can see that there's no cancer. I mean, it must have left you. So how is this possible? And she said, well, you know, why don't you start practicing spiritual practicing and you'll find out. And so he started, you know, doing spiritual practice because he saw it, that with his own eyes and experienced this. And she goes, well, you know, sometimes these forms of illnesses like to come visit me just like you like to come visit me. And they stay for a while and I don't tell them to come. I don't tell them to go away. If they want to stay, they can stay. If they want to leave, they can leave. But at some point, you know, they choose to leave, and fine, so they leave. But for me, it's just never any bother or inconvenience at all. It's nothing for me. I don't feel any suffering at all. I'm not the body at all. I'm spirit. I'm not a body. I'm free. I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. And so they say, wow. Maybe I better, you know, I want to find out this, there's some deeper truth here than science has, obviously. So science is just a parlor game, really, okay? Don't put too much stock in it. Ultimately, it's not true. It's like the humanist education. It's just all parlor game, just silly monopoly game or, you know, something. It's ultimately not true what they're telling you. It's not. It, you know, has a little bit of pragmatic value here for a while, but not that much, a little bit. So we understand that. So we're not running it down pragmatically speaking. We just say ultimately it has no value, has no truth to it really. So why do we spend so much time on it? There's a miseducation. That should be secondary education. Primary education should be how to pray properly, how to pray. That should be our education actually. How to have success on the spiritual path, how to pray, and how to pray better and better and better and better and better. This is the whole key to it. It's the absolute key to it. Why do you think the Tibetan Buddhists put so much emphasis on that? Because they've had such tremendous success. It works. That's what works. you know, someone's getting ready to die there, and everyone has a celebration. Why? Because they know that they're going to turn to a light body. So, and lots of relics and lots of empowerments, and this is a great, great thing. So they say, oh yeah, I'm gonna die in about a week, so get ready, and I'll go into this, I'm going to do my meditation, get ready, and, you know, just avoid the bardo altogether, and the body just turns into a light body and leaves a little couple of, you know, fingernails or something behind, or some relics behind. That's the path of right practice, right prayer. Get you there. Get you to that. And the culture there, and they don't know it, because and people tell each other about this. Oh, you know, I was there, and this is what happened. I was a witness to it. Now, these idiot modernist scientific folks, you know, they say, well, oh, that's all massive gnosis. Well, what about the relics? That's somebody planted those. They always have some excuse, you know, that says that people are crazy. Never happened like that. Can't. It's impossible. Our scientific laws preclude that from happening. Well, how about maybe your scientific laws are just, you know, some cheap parlor game you're playing toward describing pretense, as if pretense was a law. He says, well, yeah, everything's been pretending like this for a long time, so it has to continue that way. Really? It has to continue? We don't have free will? We can't stop pretending? Lazarus decided, I'm going to stop pretending to be dead. We can't do that. There's some sort of law that precludes our spiritual will. What kind of law is that? That sounds like arrogance, doesn't it? Sure, it sounds like arrogance. Because it is arrogance. And this is the arrogance that's ruling the roost here. Ruling the roost. And the hens are ruling the roosters here. Absolutely. And you really get it here in the Silicon Valley. Okay, you really get it here. I mean, it is just intense. As I've said, the women drivers are more aggressive than the men now here. Get out of my way. They're intimidating the men. I can't give names away and stuff, but wow, if they don't like the work you do, you know, it's your fault. And it intimidates the men. And they're like flustered by it because they can't say anything about it. They can't say, hey, wait a minute. I did a perfectly great job. What are you talking about? You can't tell me I didn't do a great job. They say, no, you screwed up. I didn't screw up, you screwed up. They can't admit that their choice that they made is wrong. They didn't like it. They say, no, you screwed up the job. And the men are put in this very awkward position. And I can tell they don't like it at all. Very, very, you know, upset about it. But they got no stance at all. And of course, the women say, well, we don't dare let them gain any sort of autonomy, because then they'll strike back, you know, because we've mistreated them so badly and humiliated them so badly. So we got to keep them in prison, you know, otherwise they'll be a strike back at us. So this is the vicious cycle that happens. You know, they say, well, we got to have more control because our control is so vicious. We got to have more control, you know, so they don't ever get free. But the men aren't that way. They get free and say, wow, I don't think I really want to go through that again. So let me start praying. Let me pray and get free of this world. Historically, that's what men have done. When they get out from under the control, they start praying. They take the spiritual path. Says, well, I don't ever want to get under that problem again. And women, too, can be bullied by other women. Absolutely, they can. Better believe it. Are you kidding? These queen bees here, I mean, the whole Silicon Valley is just a hive of queen bees, actually. It's just unbelievable. And they walk around like, you know, goddesses, we rule this place, and, you know, you're just here, you know, putting our tile up for us, and then taking it down when we decide we want something different, putting up some new stuff. And that's about it. They're nice to you when you're, you know, doing your thing. And then when you've done your thing, you know, who are you? If I need you, I'll call you. And so it's pretty amazing here. Amazing place. But you find out about, you know, egoic psychology there, the psychology of arrogance here. You really see it. You really, really see it. And they all have each other's backs too, because if you out one of them, you're outing all of them, right? So it's kind of like, you know, sisterhood is that's the way it is. You out one of them, you out all of them. So they'll stand up for one another. Absolutely they will. They say, hey, we got a good thing going here. You know, we got the Taj Mahal being built for us right here. You know, let's not mess this up. You can have the Taj Mahal too, honey. You know, sister. And they say, oh, really? Yeah. This is how you do it. So they share all these tips. You know, how do you control these guys? How do you enslave them like a dog? Tell them to bark, they bark. Tell them to attack, they attack. You know, tell them to fetch the bone, they fetch the bone. This is how it is here. And this is how it is actually globally. It always has been. But not, you know, there's different degrees of intensity. You know, it's like the bankers. Banker loan you money, and sometimes they give you a good interest rate. Sometimes, they say they'll need to adjust it. And like if you're renting an apartment, they treat you nice for a while. And they said one day, they say, you know, we need to make an adjustment on the price here, and we've got to jack the rate by 500. So you're really at their mercy. But you might say, well, my landlord's really nice, and my banker's nice. They're nice, but they really own. You know, they own the house. You know, they can kick you out of the apartment, drive you out if they want to. So you're not really in control. They are. And you just hope that they treat you nice. If they treat you nice, you say, oh yeah, I feel very comfortable and I feel safe. And this. But if for some reason they decide otherwise, oh, guess what? We're calling in that balloon loan right now, today. Whoa, you told me I'd have 5 years. Yeah, but things have changed. You know, you got to pay it now, or you got to jack on the rate $500 a month. Sorry. The cost of living thing's really getting out of hand these days. And this is happening to a lot of people I know. They're getting driven out of their living. I mean, everybody here, they say, I can't afford to live here. I'm getting driven out. They got to commute 3 hours each way. You know, they have to go into the Central Valley to afford anything. Every guy you talk to, you hear this. It's just mind blowing what's happening here. Yeah, cannot afford it. Can't afford it. We got to move out here. They couldn't afford there. We had to move there. Now we're way out there in the boondocks. You know, it's just a brutal commute. The farther away you are, the less the rent is. See, closer you are to like Google or Yahoo or Facebook, the higher the rent is. You get these ridiculous houses, these chicken coops basically selling for like $4 million. Because they're, you know, it's a hop, skip, and a jump to, you know, Apple headquarters or something, or wherever, you know. Yeah. Supply and demand is what, you know, is the competition for it is there. Because every minute counts for them. And they don't want to be stuck in a two-hour commute. I mean, the folks in San Francisco aren't very happy because a lot of tech workers went up there and drove all the prices up. Now the prices are just crazy up there. Crazy. The rent is just crazy expensive. And now they have to commute down to the Silicon Valley, a lot of them. And there's so many of them up there now that the commute down this way has now become brutal. And so they pay super high rent plus a brutal commute. That's not exactly what they had in mind. They thought they were missing the commute because it didn't used to be that way, but now it is. It's both ways now. So if they have the money, they'd move back down here near the headquarters and they pay a massive premium for it. So these queen bees are used to calling the shots, and they're so used to it that basically they can just intimidate you with their expectations that you will comply with what they say, because it's absolutely never has happened and anyone hasn't. So, you know, if you don't comply, you don't exist. In their eyes, this is what those queen bees can do to you. If you don't comply, that means that you don't even exist. Because everyone complies with me. With a smile. So you get this fear of non-existence. if you don't comply. This is what happens. This is what happens. So you know, send Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma into the picture. She said, tell her she doesn't exist. She said, of course I don't exist. There's only God that exists. So she's not afraid of non-existence in that way, you know. You want me to die? Of course I'll die. Here's a corpse for you. You want non-existence? Here's a corpse. Okay, no problem. You need someone like that to deal with these queen bee yoga girl types. I'm telling you. We need it. I've been calling on help from her for almost 20 years, you know. Yeah, and so you know, she's inscrutable. I don't know what she's going to do, but she's going to do something at this point. You can bet on it, because again, someone like this is that their whole being is entirely focused on our spiritual success, which is based on confidence and momentum and more confidence. That cycle of prayer, response to prayer, effective practice, response, you know, progress, miracles, prayers, positive results from that, building this whole body of momentum and confidence. This is what it's all about. So to lose that, I mean, you can keep the form of religion, but if you knock out prayer and knock out people talking about how successful it was and miracles and all that, if you knock that out, you got nothing but an empty corpse. You got a skeleton dressed up in a suit or a pantsuit. You got a skeleton in a pantsuit, and that's it. And that's what they want. That's the New World Order wants. So Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma, Vajrayogini, is very aware of this. And I'll, you know, we'll see what she does. Now, in Christianity, they would call it Virgin Mary. In the right sense of using the term the Virgin Mary. The New World Order has flipped the whole thing of the Virgin Mary, and now it's, you know, Virgin of Guadalupe, this kind of all this stuff. They've turned it into a pagan materialistic goddess, actually. It's just a skeleton dressed in sanctity. Okay, but the real Virgin Mary, the archetype of grace of the Holy Spirit, that archetype that can deal with the yoga girls and knock them out, you know, prevent them from undermining our spiritual confidence. Yeah, I believe that in that Virgin Mary, absolutely. Absolutely, but I've always cautioned everybody that there's a bogus Virgin Mary that's being promoted in the world, that is really just a New World Order archetype to turn us to losing our spiritual confidence. It's a trick. It's a very bad trick. The priest even talks about that. I mean, I don't want to spill in too many beans, but he says, wow, like the Hispanics, he says, they're just all about the mother, you know, Virgin Mary, they're Guadalupe, and that's it. They don't even know Jesus. They just do the prayers and they're right back to the mother thing, and they're just looking for, you know, material. He's just like blown away by, he says, this Catholicism? What is this? Well, it's a conquistador version of Catholicism, is what it is, which is materialism, slave, enslavement. Pray to the mother to give you material comforts, but don't dare pray for you know, liberation from arrogance. So, you know, they don't even know Jesus. That's what the priest keeps saying. I said, wow, man, oh man, oh man, oh man, oh man. And this Hispanic lady, she gave this testimony that she said she always used to go to the Hispanic Mass. And she said, I didn't get any, all I got was just the prayers of the Virgin, and I didn't know Jesus at all. And then I started coming to the English Mass, and I discovered Jesus. I discovered the fullness of the gospel. She said, in Hispanic culture, we don't know this fullness of the gospel at all. It is true. It is very true. This is really astonishing. they don't really know what Jesus had to say at all. They just ask the Virgin to pray for me and pray for my baby and make sure my baby's healthy and make sure my children have success in the world and I get some material comforts from them. Just family stuff, flesh stuff. They don't pray to the Virgin Mary to help me shift my attention to alpha clear light vision of intrinsic spaciousness, because that's the prayer we should be making to the Virgin Mary. Absolutely roadblock any interference with my spiritual practice. Totally thwart any attempt on anyone's part to interfere with my spiritual practice. That should be the prayer of the Virgin Mary, and absolutely negate all desire, all yoga girl tricks whatsoever, and completely nullify them for me. Thank you very much, Virgin Mary. That should be the prayers, type of prayers of the Virgin Mary. That's not happening in Catholicism much. I mean, there's some that do that, so let me be clear about that. The old guard of Catholicism still has some wisdom to them, okay? But the new third world stuff, Catholicism, no way, are you kidding? Some of them are getting a little bit of gospel from Jesus, some, sure. It's pretty weak stuff, and not enough. I mean, it's very, very, very pulled down right now. I've seen some very blasphemous stuff in the Christian Catholic Church. The Virgin of Guadalupe being put on the altar in front of Jesus and covering up Jesus. I'm just astonished by it. Just astonished by what I've seen. Well, the Mexicans insist upon it. Well, Hispanics, let's say. And they have tremendous power. The ones that are taking communion, the ones that have been confirmed now, they had a list of them in their brochure, a list of all the new ones who have been confirmed. And I went over the list, and it was like 95% Hispanics, just a few non-Hispanics. Otherwise, 95% were all Hispanics. So you really think that the church can stand up against the cult of the Virgin of Guadalupe? Are you kidding? They're saying, hey, come up on the altar and block Jesus. And it was like, it was a solemn time where you're not supposed to have anything on the altar, But though they had all these flowers and all this celebration of Virgin of Guadalupe on the altar, I said, this is blasphemous. And the priests, you can tell, it's like, man, not much we can do about it. They'd revolt if we took it off the altar. They'd leave and they'd go to another church. Now, one of the reasons for that is the Spanish conquistadors conquered the Americas under the banner of the Virgin Mary, the warrior goddess, pagan warrior goddess. And everybody in the Americas got a full dose of that, and everywhere they went, they put these images of the Virgin Mary. Not Jesus at all. They didn't even talk about Jesus. So the Americas got this idea that the way to conquer is to worship the Virgin Mary. So you've got to believe that the people of the Americas who were conquered by the Spanish, in the back of their minds, the Reconquista is very much important to them. And they believe that the Virgin Mary will help them reconquest their lands. It's exactly what they believe. So they believe she's a warrior goddess that has a power to defeat your enemies. And of course, they're very much now becoming more and more militant about Reconquista, reconquest. And they use the Virgin of Guadalupe as their warrior goddess of reconquest. And they're taking over the church, basically, more and more and more. You better believe that's what's happening. Do you really think that subjugated people, what happened to them, you really think they say, oh, it's great, no problem? No, they say, we're going to find out how you got the power to do that, and then we're going to turn the tables and do it to you. And so again, the Spanish claimed it was Virgin Mary that gave them the power to do all this. So that's why they worship the Virgin Mary, not to block, arrogance and materialism so we can shift our attention to the clear light vision of intrinsic spaciousness, but rather so they can get the warrior goddess power on their sides to strike back and pillage the Spanish, or pillage other people, and so they can get all the gold and the silver and the power. And they think the Virgin Mary, Virgin Guadalupe has the power to deliver victory in battle to them. Because that's been their experience, you see. So it adds up, doesn't it? Now you're hearing real politics of the world, real spiritual politics. What can the Pope say except go there and bow to it, right? And they create a mythology, you know, to make it seem like it's all possible and miracle and all that stuff. Yeah, I don't want to get into all that, but this is the real politics that's going on. So you see these trends in the world. There are these spiritual, these trends. You see, these really are happening now. And the conquest is happening of the United States, actually. Southwest of the United States, the conquest is happening. It most definitely is. Absolutely it is. It hasn't happened with war right at this point. It's a cultural conquest. When you get 95% of the new members of the Catholic Church being Hispanic, that's a pretty strong conquest. Pretty soon they're going to be running everything in that regard. And then using the power of the Virgin Mary and the church to pressure everything else. Now I tell you, those Hispanic women, when you start waving the Virgin Mary around, they get pretty excited. You know, that's our warrior goddess right there. That's the one that's going to deliver us all the material, you know, bounty that we ask for. She's going to get it for us. She has the miracle to defeat our enemies, so that we can conquer. That's in a lot of their hearts. It really is. They're very much into a reconquest here. Very much so. They hide behind their men, of course. Men are very nice, as men tend to be. But the women have very strong awareness of this reconquest thing. Because, of course, they got devastated by the conquistadors. Their families, their children, everybody, they all got killed and died. So, you know, they didn't appreciate that one bit. And so they've plotted revenge since that time. Most certainly have. And there's nothing like a woman who's plotting revenge. That is for sure. Men tend to let it go a lot easier, that sort of thing. Yeah, what can we do? We're slaves, you know. Just gotta go to work tomorrow. But no. The cultural heart is women. Culture, heart, civilization is women. And when you get conquered like that, the women do plot revenge. And even if it takes 1,000 years, they'll get revenge for it. So this is what they're actually doing. They're using the Virgin Mary as their means to do this. But this isn't the real Virgin Mary. There is this grace of God that, of this, you might call it this capability to block the feminine arrogance, okay, and enable us to succeed on our spiritual path. And that, call that the Virgin Mary if you want, or in Vajrayana Buddhism, you call it, you know, Vajrayogini, or you call it various terms, Kali, the Hindus, Kali or something. Yeah, that really does exist. That's a grace of God. And it really can block the arrogance of these ones wanting to take vengeance. Vengeance is mine, saith the Lord. Jesus says attack is never justified, because there's nothing that can happen to us that isn't our own desire to experience this. So nothing has ever happened to us, to anyone. If they study the gospel of Jesus, they would be enlightened. But they're so intent on vengeance. The whole world, there's so many deep-seated desires for vengeance in the world, you'd be shocked. Someone told me about this. It was just recently. Wow, it's just really amazing. Well, the Italians, I think, about towards the German, or what was it? There's some, you know, in Europe, there's always a lot of vengeance in Europe, and there's tremendous vengeance in Serbia, Bosnia, Croatia, and all this stuff. Oh, there's the women have a tremendous desire for vengeance. A lot of Italian, you know, they talk about, oh, no, somebody told me about Italy. Oh, yeah, Italians are harboring some desire for vengeance. these things are embedded in these cultures, these pagan cultures, and the women, the ones that really carry them through to their children, they say, we'll never forget, and they teach their children this tremendous hatred, and we need, you know, vengeance. The Jewish people may, you know, they're probably harboring a lot of desire for vengeance on the various situations that they've experienced here in this world. There's a tremendous repository of vengeance, and when your desire is for vengeance, it blinds you to spiritual truth. It totally blinds you. That's why Jesus said that the forgiveness is the key. If you don't have forgiveness, you can't learn the gospel. It will, vengeance will blind you to it, because you refuse to believe that there's no cause for vengeance, because nothing can happen to anyone without their choosing it to happen. Now, they've chosen it because of their arrogance, probably, but it's still their choice. So there's no grounds for vengeance, Jesus says. There's no grounds whatsoever for vengeance. Well, try selling that to the people of the world, especially the mothers and grandmothers of those, you know, genocides have been carried out, taken place in their countries and wars and things. You're not going to get anywhere with that. They're very hard-hearted about this. This is what I've found. Women can seem to be very nice and spiritual stuff, but when you get into this vengeance issue, that's where they draw the line and say, no, I'm going to get my vengeance because someone killed my son or killed my daughter or whatever, you know. No, I'm going to get my vengeance. You don't dare. Jesus could never possibly tell me that I shouldn't have the right, don't have the right for vengeance. So they draw the line, whereas Jesus starts the line there. Says vengeance is never, attack is never justified. There's no, never a call for vengeance. This is where he starts his teaching. Okay, so there's a big difference, isn't it, between these two camps. Between the camps that believe in vengeance and those who believe in forgiveness. Because there's nothing to forgive. This is already, all is forgiven. Because there's no need to forgive. Nothing's ever happened to anyone. In fact, no one's ever even been born. It's all pretense. It's all 100% pretense. They told Sri Sri Nanda, my mom, well, why aren't you upset by all the people being killed in World War II? She goes, what war? What are you talking about? And they said, well, what do you mean? It's in the newspaper. She says, there's no war going on. There's nothing going on. It's just all pretense. It's just a game everyone's playing. Funny, silly little game. That's it. This is literally how she saw it. And this is true. This is just, she's seeing it truly. She saw it truly. And they said, wow, you know, just try saying that today. You know, people say, you're crazy. And if they told her she's crazy, she said, yeah, I am. I know. I was, you know, born that way. I can't help it, you know. And they just kind of shrug, and people just shrug themselves. Oh, well, crazy lady. What can we do? She's nice, though. She's really nice. We really love her, but she's crazy. I mean, no war going on. What the heck is she talking about? You know, but no, she's absolutely serious. There's no war going on ever. There's never been any war take place, actually. It's only, as she says, friends playing a silly little game with other friends of fall down and get up, fall down and get up. That's literally what it is, literally. But we pretend otherwise. So we have to keep this game of arrogance going by believing in vengeance. And really, I try to preach this, and people, they don't like that at all. I mean, I have to shut my mouth. How dare you talk about it? Somebody just did this terrible thing. I said, no, nothing happened. And, you know, no, that was meant to happen. If someone had something happen, they desire that to happen for them. You can't blame the other person for that. They just participated to try to hide the fact that someone was desiring something bad to happen to themselves, so they didn't have to admit that they're arrogant. And people, they draw the line there. But this is where Jesus' teaching starts. So basically, they're totally ignoring his teaching. And then that's when they turn to the Virgin Mary, their concept of it, and say, well, she believes in vengeance. At least she believes. She knows what it's like to be a mother and to lose your child and have your child crucified. So I'm sure that, you know, she would agree with me that vengeance is justified. So really, the false Virgin Mary is all based on vengeance. And then so many women pray to her because in their hearts, they feel they've been wronged in some way, or some member of their family has been wronged, and they want to right that wrong, and that she understands that desire for vengeance, whereas Jesus doesn't seem to. And they say, well, Jesus, yeah, he's a nice guy, but, you know, for some reason, he just doesn't seem to really, you know, I don't think he'd really support me enough, but she saw, Virgin Mary saw Jesus die on the cross and be crucified unjustly, so she knows the desire for vengeance, and she knows what it feels like to be a mother and to watch your son die that way, so certainly she will approve of my great hatred and vengeance and to it. But once I carry out my vengeance, then I'm sure she'll forgive me, and Jesus will forgive me and say, okay, it was justified. And if Jesus disapproves, she'll go to Jesus and say, look, son, you know, look, you got to understand how mother feels, and you got to approve that his vengeance is okay, and Jesus, and they'll say, oh, okay, mom, I guess you're right. This is what they believe. This is what they literally believe. And this is totally contrary to Jesus' teaching. 100% contrary. In no way could his mother ever go to him and tell him, hey, Jesus, guess what? The guy, you know, he got killed. That was the murderer's fault. It wasn't his fault. And you're wrong about that. And Jesus would say, no, you're wrong about that. Nothing can ever happen to any one of us. It's impossible. So you're the one who's wrong about that. You're the one who has to repent. You're the one who has to correct the mistake. Jesus would never agree with his mother telling some untruth about truth. Never, 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 never. Not possible. Okay, so they're totally wrong about this. This is their religion. This is a false religion. It's a very false religion. So I'm outing it right now. This video is outing it here, which is great, because we haven't been able to out it up till this point, but now we've finally been able to out this. And it's helpful for everyone. Helpful for everyone, because mistakes have to be corrected. There are a lot of hard hearts in the world, I'm telling you this. There's a lot of very nice people who are harboring desire for vengeance. This is very, very common in the world. And that's why you can't reach him. I can't reach him. I keep trying to preach the gospel and I'm not reaching anybody. Because it starts with that nothing has ever happened. You can't be victimized. That's where it starts with. It starts there. It goes from there. That's Jesus' gospel. Forgive your enemies. Love your enemies, forgive those who do wrong unto you, and a lot of stuff. And his whole gospel is truth. And it's completely opposite of the gospel of vengeance that the world believes in. And most people have not even gotten to Jesus' gospel. Most Christians have not quite gotten to it. You know, some have. Praise God that some have. To some extent. And not really, because they say, well, yeah, this guy killed my son, but I forgive him. I have no animosity towards him. Okay, this, it's not quite Christianity yet. Okay, it's not. It's self-righteousness. What you should say, which is true, is my son decided that he wanted to die at the hand of someone else, make it seem like it was at the hand of someone else instead of just his own suicide. So he had someone else collaborate with him. They did a friend, and they carried out this little charade of pretense of his death, and that's what really happened. So there's nothing to forgive. That he had the right to do that. He's free will, and he had the right to do that. But I haven't heard too many women ever saying that about their son's death. Have you? In fact, I've never heard it. I've never heard it. So that's real Christianity. Because that's Jesus' real gospel. And I've yet to hear a real Christian speak up in the world, speak up on this. Okay, maybe I'm the first Christian here to speak up on this, you might say. Because this is the truth. This is the truth. And mothers have a very tough time with the truth when it comes to their children. They might be able to see it with somebody else, maybe, but with their own children, wow. That's where they draw the line. They said, no, my son would never do that, or my daughter would never do that. She wouldn't want to take her own life in that way, no way. But of course they would. This is all a dance of arrogance and pretense, and this strengthens arrogance and pretense. And this is, all death is suicide. Jesus said, all death is suicide, period. Nobody causes the death of another. It's impossible. This is the real gospel of Jesus Christ. And there are precious few spreading this gospel around, because women just hit the roof when you try to tell them this. Not my son, not my daughter, no one in my family. You crazy? No way. And they get very, very belligerent about this. But I've got to say this. This is a fact. This is a fact. This is the true gospel of Jesus Christ. So you reject this, you're rejecting Jesus Christ. You're rejecting sanctuary with Jesus Christ too. Plain and simple. As Jesus said, there's nothing to forgive. The final judgment is our judgment. There's nothing to judge. There's never been anything to judge. So, you know, the women don't like me, and mothers don't like me. They don't like me. They don't like the truth. They don't like the gospel of Jesus Christ is what they don't like. So they've built up a fake religion in the name of Jesus, really worshiping the mother goddess, who they're sure that she understands their desire for vengeance and lack of forgiveness on this, and that might, you know, they know how a mother really feels. She knows how a mother really feels. This is a fake religion they've built up. It's a fake religion. It's not a true religion at all. And this is what's ruling the roost, you know. Absolutely it is. Absolutely it is. Nothing can ever happen to anyone. Nothing has ever happened to anyone. So they should be happy of the power and freedom that, quote unquote, their son has. But what do you mean? It's not their son. It's God's son. They're just engaging in a pretense with this aspect of spirit, pretending that they're being born, that I'm pretending I gave birth to you, this body gave birth to this body, and now this body's living here in this world, that they're engaging with a pretense for their own arrogance. So they're not willing to look at their own arrogance. Some are. Few are. I bet some women are willing to do this. I've got to be some. There's got to be some that decide, okay, you know, this is true. But I wouldn't count on a lot of them doing this. It's easier for a father to look at this way, right? But a mother, real tough. It's difficult for fathers, but it's probably a little easier. They could say, well, maybe I can see how that's possible, yeah. But for some reason, the mothers, they just say, no way. I can't go that far. So give me a Jesus that doesn't teach this, and I'll worship him every day of my life, but I refuse to worship a Jesus that teaches what you're saying. This is what they literally, this is their attitude. So how in the heck is anyone supposed to get anywhere with them? You know, they won't listen to truth at all. Because this is the starting point of truth. You cannot throw that out and go on any sort of spiritual path at all, not any real path at all, that leads to you shifting your attention to the clear light vision of intrinsic spaciousness. You won't get there. You won't get there at all. So you're just basically doing secular humanism dressed up in self-righteousness. That's all that's happening. I'm feeling pretty good today, aren't I? Yeah. I worked out today. A little bit. Yeah. Did pretty good. Yeah. Did pretty good. It's pretty amazing. I'm getting in better shape, and I could scoot it out away of that car. Interesting, that woman, she looked like a nice Christian woman, tried to kill me, basically. Yeah. So I was able to scoot out of her way. So I think I feel very empowered by that. But she was trying to help me by saying, hey, you know, maybe it's time for you to spill the beans here. She kind of woke me up, maybe. Thank you. Holy Spirit Center, for sure, for sure. See, thank everyone that comes to your way in your life. Thank them because the Holy Spirit sent them in your life. Look at it that way, because it's true. When you ask the Holy Spirit to help you, then those who come into your life are designed to help you. If you have arrogance to help you, those come into your life are designed to increase your arrogance. That's how it works. So I surprised myself by my workout today. I was like, wow. I said, I'm kind of getting in better shape here, aren't I? Yeah. But I've never heard this gospel that I'm presenting here in this video, in this world. I've never heard anyone talk like this, because they're, you know, whatever reticence they have has, you know, tied their tongues. But we don't have any more time to fool around here anymore. Okay, we have to tell it as it really is here, and with this video has really done that. And as a woman, you absolutely can repent. All you have to do is accept what we've said here, and you can do it. I know it's tough, but you can do it. Absolutely, you can. It's not your children. These are just friends that decided you had to play this role of mother child, so you could work on your arrogance together. increase, you know, strengthen your arrogance and belief in this pretension is real. But the whole thing is all pretend. It's mental dreaming. It's just a dream. The mind is just dreaming all this. There's no real mother. There's no real child. No one's ever been born. The mother has never been born. The child has never been born. We're not here. We're not bodies at all. And everything that happens is everyone's choice, including infants, including children. An infant is still 100% the pretense of spirit for the purpose of a grand arrogance, just as much as an old person would be. So whatever happens to an infant, that is also desired by spirit just as much. Just a body. It doesn't matter the age of the body. The body's neutral. There's no light, real life in a body at all. So people say, well, yeah, I can understand maybe older person, but my baby died. Oh, you know, someone did something to my baby. That's unforgivable. No, it's the exact same thing. It's the exact same thing, actually. Age has nothing to do with it. I know that's a tough one for people. This is where the rubber hits the road. And most people just can't go there. But you have to have faith in Jesus to go there. You have to have faith in Jesus to go there. And it's tough. Of course it's tough. It's not easy for anyone. Not easy for me. But I've had to work at it, and realize this is what Jesus is saying. There's no way around it. There's no way around it. He's not backing down from this one bit. Never will. Never will. So we got no choice but to accept what he has to say. Tough medicine, tough love, tough medicine, but we've got to take the medicine. So this idea of a mother being the super important person and all this kind of stuff is nonsense. They're just part of this dance of pretense, of arrogance. That's all that it is. Same thing with the father. It's all a dance of arrogance. Now, a mother can play a helpful role. You can have a helpful role if you teach your children the truth. You say, hey, you know, this is the way it really is. You know, you're a sovereign spiritual being pretending you're a child. But you really have all power. But I understand that we're all pretending a bit here, so I'll help take care of you this and we'll play this role. But let's make it clear that in no way am I superior to you. You're superior to me. We're all totally empowered spiritual beings every moment, every instant. And there's no exception to that whatsoever. Whatever happens to you, it's really your choice. You know, and they can help verify the truth for their children. They can do that, and that's very helpful. Very helpful. There's some women that do that. I came across one non-dual woman teacher that told her children the truth, you know, and she had a tough time of it, and people really vilified her. That, you know, I'm not really the mom that you think I am at all. This is all just a dream. It's all pretense. And she said, well, my children can handle the truth. Very courageous woman. I can't remember her name. I think she's some German or something. But I think she might kind of have been tilting a little bit in some ways. It's tough, you know. It's hard to judge that. I'll just let it be for now. But she certainly made efforts in that direction. Very courageous. But boy, social workers would take away your children here, right? So you've got to... You know, women have tried to empower their children with the truth, and at least accept the truth that the children also have. But they've, you know, done it within the context of religion, and they kind of say, let's not go too far with it. And then in Christian Science, they went a lot further with it. New Thought, they went a lot further. And now there's this backlash against all that, where now women see that as just horrible. You know, and the social workers would come in like Nazis and take your children away if you started to talk in this manner, you know? The children talk to their teachers, and teachers start investigating, and social workers send social workers to investigate, and they put you in jail and take your children away now. So I understand that it's really tough for women and men these days with children. But you can at least hear what's being said here, and in your heart you can realize this is the truth. And if your children tell you something, you know, mom, I think that, you know, this is the truth, you can just say, well, you know, there's some diplomatic way of, without agreeing with it, because that might get you in trouble if they talk to their teachers about it. You just say, you know, I do believe we're all spiritual beings, and we're here for a purpose, and we're all equal in spirit, and however you want to see that, I support you in that, and so in other words, be supportive of the truth without maybe necessarily trying to like preach the truth, because you might get in trouble. It's possible, right? I mean, it is, especially because of ambivalence. You might pull trouble down on your head at some point. So hear the truth, get used to the truth, support the truth in ways that you can. Don't oppose it, for sure. Don't oppose the truth. I could make this another long video, couldn't I? But it's late. Do I have to get up early tomorrow? Maybe not. I didn't sleep at all last night. It's pretty amazing. I got this energy. I don't know what's happening. Well, I took a nap. I slept for an hour and a half because I was just I had a brutal night. Couldn't sleep. It was just terrible. Didn't drink any coffee. Hardly ate anything today. I did eat a little bit. What did I have for breakfast? I had yogurt, blueberries, and walnuts. That was a good breakfast. And had a sandwich for lunch, sourdough, avocado, and cheese sandwich. And then I had a garbanzo bean and tabbouleh salad and salsa mix and feta cheese for dinner. So I did, and a cookie. So I did eat today. I had a good reading on the scale this morning. Pretty good. And we'll see what it is tomorrow. Maybe it'll be a little heavier because I've eaten a little more. But I'm kind of slacking off of eating quite a bit. I feel pretty hungry. So, I think I would be very tired today with no sleep and not eating. But somehow that exercise pumped me up, and I've got some energy now. Pretty amazing. But I'm sure I'm going to feel it here in a moment or two. Yeah. So, enjoy the artistic videos, the graphics and stuff I put up. I love them. I love doing them. It's part of the 360 degree shift to clear light vision of intrinsic spaciousness that we're involved with here. Our practice is 360 degree. Relax into this. It comes at it from all angles. Okay, so just appreciate this angle. It's very aesthetically beautiful. If you get out of it what you put into it. If you use your imagination, just like music, if you really use your imagination with a song and put your emotion and feeling into it, it feels like the song gets spacious, doesn't it? And you feel this great spaciousness to the song, and you just feel, wow, the world is alive with the sound of music. Same thing with graphics like this. If you really put your heart and spirit into it, then I'm getting great benefit. I'm feeling like this richness of I'm feeling echoes of the sublime. If you really want to see it, then it's going to take on this great spaciousness and feeling of very sublime, and the colors will seem very vivid to you. Absolutely, they will. It's amazing when you're not into something how bland everything looks, but if you're really into it, how vivid it looks and spacious it looks. It gets to spaciousness and vividness, which is ultimately Rigpa abiding in the clear light vision of intrinsic spaciousness. This everything has this great vividness and feeling of great spaciousness to it. Everything has this vast spaciousness to it, and vividness and beauty and sublimeness to it. That's the state we're going to abide in. That's a successful spiritual path. That's what it leads to. And of course, Sri Sri Anandamayi would say, yeah, this cancer, this has got great vividness and spaciousness to it. I'm really enjoying this. Wow, it's just beautiful. It's very sublime. And the doc would say, and the devotee would say, Maya, you're going to die for this. Come on, please, can you stand on that way? Oh, but it's so beautiful. I'm just enjoying this so much. And then she said, well, there's other things I can enjoy too. Everything's enjoyable too. So, okay, you want me around for a while longer? Okay. Poof, illness is gone. It's okay, gone. Onto the next thing, wandering through the park. And she said, but the illnesses, she said, they're just as beautiful as everything else. Smallpox, she says, the form of smallpox is very beautiful in form and spaciousness and vividness. It's like gorgeous, sublime. It's all God. It's all God. And it's true. What she was saying is true. Her husband died of smallpox. Now, could she have cured or something? She says, You know, it's his karma, she said. This is what he's choosing. Isn't that amazing? He got the bad kind of smallpox. Middle age. He wasn't that old. And he was greatly revered. Great, great man. Great sadhu. Great spiritual practitioner, Bolanath, to say the least. And he's one of my favorites. Spiritual protector, if we ask him. He probably has stepped in at certain points because I have asked him. I will ask him. Let's ask him right now. Bolanath, absolutely. We give you full empowerments and permissions to step in and help us in any and every way and guard the Dharma, guard our spiritual momentum and our path and our success. Thank you. And we ask in Jesus' name, amen, with that one. And so he caught smallpox, and it was the bad kind, and everybody knew he's going to die. And everybody said, well, don't worry, she will cure it. Suddenly, my throat. Wow. Wow. Suddenly got hit there, very strong. My face. Reaction to saying this, wow. Wow, that just came out of the blue, didn't it? Totally unexpected. He just hit my throat, suddenly my throat, and it affected my breathing and speaking. It's still there. Okay, maybe I should not then talk about this at this time. I've talked about it before, but maybe not right at this time. Let us back off of this. Good grief. What to make of it, I don't know exactly, but this happens before. It's happened at... If I push far enough, something or backlash happens or something. Wow. So full stop in the wow. Maybe we have enough wow for now. We can save this for another time. Absolutely, we can. I've got to be conscious of the wow that the audience, you know, those are listening, sharing this with me, going through this experience. You know, they build up a big wow hearing all of this, for sure. Very intense. It's been very intense. So we don't need to drag the intensity into even greater intensity at this point. That's probably what it was. That's enough. Holy Spirit stepped in. Yeah, that's enough. We've covered so much territory here. This most extraordinary video. I could go all night, but enough is enough for one video. So thank you for the grace of that, of saying, okay, enough's enough. So with that, without further ado, let us say adieu for this video. Full stop in the wow. That's the key. Full stop in the wow.